Hello guys, in today's video we'll study the Cannizzaro reaction. The Cannizzaro reaction is named after its discoverer, Stanislaw Cannizzaro. It is a chemical reaction that involves the base-induced disproportionation of two molecules of non-enolizable aldehyde that gives a primary alcohol and a carboxylic acid. So first we'll look at the terms here. A non-enolizable aldehyde is an aldehyde which has no alpha hydrogen present. It simply means that the carbonyl carbon does not have any such carbon attached to it which has hydrogen atoms. Now, what is a base-induced disproportionation? Simply, a base-induced disproportionation is a disproportionation reaction, which means that the same atom or the same molecule undergoes both oxidation as well as reduction in the presence of a base, hence it is base induced. Cannizzaro first accomplished this transformation in 1853, so you can see that he did it quite a long time ago, and hence this reaction is now quite popular. There he obtained benzyl alcohol and potassium benzoate from the treatment of benzaldehyde with potash. Potash is the common name for potassium carbonate. Nowadays the reaction is conducted in the presence of sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide, giving sodium or potassium carboxylate salt of the carboxylic acid product. We get the sodium or potassium carboxylate salt because the hydrogen is quite acidic and it's easily lost in the solution, and sodium or potassium being present in the solution in excess due to the presence of the base come and attach to the negative charge of the oxygen. Let's now see how the reaction proceeds. You can see the OH minus attacks the carbonyl carbon here. The carbonyl carbon has a partial positive charge on it because the oxygen, being more electronegative, pulls the electrons towards itself. Now you can see we have a tetrahedral intermediate here. Also, I'd like to point out this is a non-enolizable aldehyde. Why? Because this is the alpha carbon, and this alpha carbon does not have any hydrogen attached to it. Hence, we have a non-enolizable aldehyde. Here you can see now we have a tetrahedral sort of intermediate. Not exactly an intermediate, it is a product of the first reaction. The pi bonds electrons went to the oxygen, and there is a negative charge on the oxygen now. Now this hydrogen gets shifted and goes to this carbon, this carbonyl carbon, because this negative charge wants to come back and reform the pi bond. Now you can see the pi bond has been reformed and this product is here, while this hydrogen getting attached to this carbonyl carbon eventually resulted in the formation of this benzyl alcohol. Now let's take a look at the mechanism of this reaction. You can see we start off with the aldehyde. The OH minus attacks this carbonyl carbon. The electrons present in the pi bond go to the oxygen. The oxygen now has a negative charge here, while the OH is now attached here. Now you can see another molecule of OH is attacking and abstracting this hydrogen, forming a doubly negative charged ion. This is because if the base is present in excess, it will continue abstracting the acidic hydrogens, and hence we get a doubly negative charged ion. Now we can let's take a look what will happen if we start off with this structure right here. You can see now this hydride is being shifted. It goes here. This is the shifted hydride, while the negative charge of the oxygen comes back, forming a pi bond right here. You can see there is a OH present, and OH is present here, while there is now a negative charge on this oxygen, as when the hydride shifted, this pi bond was broken and the electrons went to the oxygen. Now here we have a choice whether to leave the hydrogen right here or leave it with the oxide ion. Now we choose to give the hydrogen to the oxide ion because the negative charge here is highly resonance stabilized, while it wouldn't be so if we had left the negative charge with this oxygen. Hence this structure is more stable, these pair of structures are more stable compared to the initial pair we had. Hence, we finally get this product in the reaction. Now, if we had started off with this doubly negatively charged ion, you can see the reaction proceeds in the same way. The hydride ion is shifted. There is a pi bond formation right here. You can see now we have, from the beginning only the oxygen has a negative charge and this oxygen has a negative charge as well. So when we dissolve it in the solvent, this oxygen takes the hydrogen because the negative charge here wasn't resonance stabilized, while this negative charge is still in resonance, and we can clearly see that there would be two equivalent resonating structures. Hence this product would be very highly stable, and these pair of products would be much more stable than the ones we had earlier. Hence you can see why we chose to give the negative charge to the carboxylic acid derivative and not to the alcohol we had formed. Here's another important piece of information which I would like to share. Due to the strongly alkaline reaction condition, if the aldehyde had alpha hydrogens, they would have been abstracted very easily. They would have undergone deprotonation and we'd have enolates formed. These enolates would have then proceeded via aldol reactions. I have already made an aldol reaction video in Hindi, so if you want, you can watch that as well. Under ideal condition, the reaction produces only 50% of the alcohol. You can clearly see that with 2 moles of the initial benzaldehyde, we got 1 mole of benzyl alcohol and 1 mole of carboxylic acid. It takes 2 aldehydes to produce 1 acid and 1 alcohol. So it has a 50% yield in ideal conditions. To avoid the low yields, it is more common to conduct the crossed Cannizzaro reaction, in which a sacrificial aldehyde is used in combination with a more valuable chemical. The sacrificial aldehyde is generally an aldehyde which we can easily obtain in our surroundings or in the lab, and we don't really care what happens to it. We want another product with a more valuable chemical. In this variation, the reductant is formaldehyde. Formaldehyde is very easily available, which is oxidized to sodium formate, and the other aldehyde chemical is reduced to the alcohol. So we have successfully converted the more valuable chemical to the alcohol. In this scenario, each of the 2 separate aldehydes can be converted completely to its corresponding product rather than losing 50%. So we have a very high yield as compared to the initial condition. Rather than losing 50% of a single reactant to each of the different products. Earlier we were losing 50% of the product as carboxylic acid and getting 50% as the alcohol. But if we only need the alcohol, why form the carboxylic acid? Hence we use a sacrificial aldehyde, which is generally formaldehyde. The formaldehyde very easily converts to sodium formate. Sodium formate is the carboxylic acid, sodium salt of the carboxylic acid formed on the oxidation of formaldehyde, which is formic acid. So we get sodium formate as the byproduct, while the other aldehyde gets converted to the alcohol fairly easily.